Hello, students of Dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker with an example video on the topic of rigid body kinetics using work and energy. So it's going to be two example videos total. This first one will deal with a single rigid body, and then the next problem will deal with multiple rigid bodies. We can kind of take a look how they're the same and they're different. Essentially, multiple bodies are just going to add more effort into that problem. So what we have is we have a horizontal and vertical wall. And there is a rigid bar, which is going to start vertical along this wall. Let's call the top point here point A, the bottom point here point B. And it is going to be pulled by a 50-pound force. So call this P is equal to 50 Newton force. And so its initial position is going to be vertical. Its final position as it falls down the wall is going to be at a 45-degree angle. So we could measure this angle from the wall over here and say that this angle, theta, is equal to 45 degrees. And so the final location, this is going to be B, and this end over here is going to be A. Okay, so fairly simple problem. Let's go ahead and outline the terms. So we have a 0.8 meter long, and the mass is 10 kilograms. We're going to say this is a slender rod. So we can say it starts vertically at rest. And then is pulled by a P is equal to 50 Newton horizontal force across a smooth surface. So both the wall and the floor will both be smooth. And we want to find the angular velocity when the angle theta is equal to 45 degrees. All right, so there's my problem statement, my geometry. I've got this 0.8 meter long rod. So we're going to use work energy. The reason we're going to use work energy is this is a velocity-based problem asking about angular velocity, and it is also a distance-based problem, right? We know how far this arm moves because we're given all the geometry. If it was a time-based problem, time and velocity, we might think about using impulse momentum. But because we have distance and velocity, we're going to use work energy. So I'm going to be pretty methodical in this example and kind of go through step by step. Now, just to review that our general equation for work energy, I'll put this in terms of the very general. Kinetic energy 1 plus my gravitational potential energy, so call this PE sub G1, plus the potential energy of my springs plus my sum of external work from 1 to 2 is going to be equal to the same terms final kinetic energy to final plus potential energy due to gravitation final plus potential energy of my spring final. Okay, so just noting this is equation is continuing on to the next line. So I can think about these terms even before I, start creating diagrams or anything else. And so some important terminology in the problem. We have it initially at rest. That means that both my initial velocity and my angular velocity are going to be zero. Now, the potential energy is going to depend on where I put my datum. So we'll go ahead and leave both of those, initial and final. My spring energy, I don't have any springs in this problem. So I can go ahead and get rid of these two elastic potential energy terms. I'll need to take a look at my free body diagram to think about what work terms may be included. And I know I'm going to have a final kinetic energy because I'm asked to solve for the final angular velocity. So expanding my final kinetic energy term, let's go ahead and say that our Ke sub 2 from the general equation is equal to 1 half mv2 bar squared plus 1 half I bar omega 2 squared. Now, the reason that I'm not using the ICZV form of this, I guess just kind of a matter of personal preference. I'm actually going to use the ICZV to relate my linear velocity to my angular velocity, but we'll just go ahead and show how we'd work through this using the separate kinetic energy terms. And so putting some values into our what we know that this is a constant, 1/2, our mass is 10 kilograms, our velocity is still an unknown, v bar 2 squared. We add to that the rotational kinetic energy, 1/2. My mass moment inertia about the centroid of a slender rod is 1/12 the mass of 10 times the length squared, 0.8 squared. So that's all my mass moment inertia, and then that is times omega 2 squared. So figuring out what the numeric value of the right side is of all the things that we know, we have the value of 5 times v bar 2 squared plus 0.267 times omega 2 squared. Okay, so two unknowns there currently in our kinetic energy. Now, because this is a velocity-based problem, it's actually fairly simple to find the ICZV of this body. In order to find the ICZV, we would recognize that my velocity of A is coming down the wall, so that would be VA. The velocity of B is going to move over here to the right, that's going to be VB. And so in this final location, 45 degrees off of vertical, we can see that we could locate the ICZV of this body here at the corner of the intersecting lines. Now, conveniently, we also could take a look at this system and look at an extension line that goes back here to the centroid, right? This is the centroid G of that body AB, and we would find a extension line here. Now, I didn't get this perfectly drawn at a 45, 45, 90, so this didn't quite end up being a perpendicular angle, but that should be at this angle. We know, of course, that because this is 45, this bisecting a 90 is going to be 45, so therefore this has to be 90. And so we'd also see that this is going to be our V bar. Okay, so we can actually use that information and essentially interpret between the velocity of our centroid, and then in this process we could also pick up that our omega has to be going in this direction here, negative from the right-hand rule, in order to match up with these various velocities. All right, so figuring out the distances, we can see that if the hypotenuse, the overall length of this slender rod, is a distance of 0.8 meters, then vertically here, this is going to be 0.8 times either the sine or cosine of 45. Let's go ahead and call this one 0.8 times the cosine of 45. And then if we needed it, this distance here would be 0.8 times the sine of 45 degrees. All right, so that just gives us some geometry to work with. And then the last piece of geometry that we would need is this distance between the IC back over to the centroid. And we can actually find that one because we can recognize that the distance from A to the centroid is going to be half of the length. Okay, so that one's going to be 0.4, half of 0.8. And so being a isosceles triangle with two sides equal, this side over here also has to be 0.4 meters. Okay, I know that was quite a bit of geometry to walk through there, but that's just the geometry we need in order to use our ICZV of this body. Now, this is another reason that velocity-based problems are so much easier than acceleration-based. In an acceleration-based problem, you'd be forced to use your vector analysis to figure out the acceleration of these various points. But here in a velocity-based, we can use ICZVs, which are much quicker. So since we're focused on this problem on the velocity of the centroid and the final omega, omega 2, it turns out we don't need to bring in VA and VB, but essentially we can just use the ICZV and the centroid, and we can write the equation that our velocity 2 of the centroid, V bar 2, is equal to our omega 2, our final angular velocity, times my r of that centroid relative to my instantaneous center of zero velocity. Now, the reason I can go ahead and write this as a scalar value, because of course we know that in a vector sense, v is equal to omega cross r, but we went ahead and identified that our r and our velocity are certainly perpendicular in this case, and it's going to be true always coming from an ICZV. And so now all we have to do is plug in that value of 0.4, and we can find here that our V bar 2 is equal to 0.4, which is the length of that distance between the ICZV and the centroid, times omega 2. Okay, so a really convenient equation in order to reduce the number of our unknowns based upon an ICZV. Now, keeping in mind in this problem that we were asked to find the angular velocity, and so I'm going to go ahead and put my kinetic energy 2 all in terms of angular velocity. So putting in this value here for my velocity, making sure that I square it, I end up with 5 times 0.4 omega 2, the whole thing squared, plus 0.267 times omega 2 squared, which this equals, pushing this through a calculator, 1.067 omega 2 squared. All right, so that was kind of the heavy lift on this problem, was figuring out my final kinetic energy. It turns out that the rest of the terms are quite a bit simpler, and so I'll do those kind of here more on the fly. Now, because this is a kinetics problem, we do need a free body diagram. Every single kinetics problem needs a free body diagram. Here is my normal force at B. I have additionally, perpendicular to the wall, a normal force at A. At my 50 Newton force pulling horizontally to the left, and then I also have a weight force, right, which is going to be 10 kilograms times 9.81 in meters per second squared, which is my gravitational constant for the acceleration in SI units. Now I'm going to go ahead and map out on here some of those distances. We talked about them a little bit before in the ICZV, but horizontally, we know that between B and the wall is going to be 0.8 times the sine of 45 degrees, and then vertically from the centroid down to the ground is going to be 0.4 cosine of 45 degrees. And so those would both be assuming the sines and cosines that we're using theta up here in the upper right corner. Now, of course, sine and cosine of 45 are both the same value, but just to be explicit about it. So this is our free body diagram. Now the kinetic diagram is also fairly simple on this one. So let's go ahead and add the terms to the same diagram. We know that our V bar was perpendicular to that R vector up at the ICZV, so it's actually coming down this bar, at least at this instant. And then we could also recognize that given that velocity, that our omega has to be negative from the right-hand rule as the body rotates. Okay, so our combined free body diagram and kinetic diagram. And the big reason we need a free body diagram on this kind of problem is we need to think about work terms, right? We haven't talked about those yet, those external work terms. So I have four forces total, two normal forces, one pulling force of 50 newtons, and a weight force. Take a few seconds and see if you can determine which of these forces do work. Go ahead and pause the video. All right, now that you're back from pausing the video, looking at these forces. The first ones to look at here are the normal forces. Now, these normal forces are perpendicular to surfaces, and the key criteria you're looking for whether forces cause work is if there's displacement in the direction of the force. If you think about the displacement of point A, we could call this R sub A, it's coming down the wall. The displacement of B is going horizontal across here, call this R sub B. Those displacements are both perpendicular to these forces. Being perpendicular, there's not going to be a dot product between RA and NA or between RB and NB. And so it turns out normal forces just commonly do not do any work. Okay, I always take a look at them. There could be some kind of nuance they're causing work, but in standard systems or common systems, they don't do any work. Now, the next force we'll take a look at is this weight force. The weight force we're going to choose to include in the equation as gravitational potential energy versus the work of a weight. Okay, you don't want to include it as both. You want to choose one or the other. And so we're going to include that as our gravitational potential energy, which leaves one single force, which is actually doing external work, which is this 50 newtons. And we can think that the distance over which that 50 newtons applies its work is going to be the distance from the wall over to where point B is in the final location. So we can write that W prime from 1 to 2 of this 50 newton force is equal to the 50 newton force times a distance of 0.8 times the sine of 45 degrees. Now, you do always need to answer on a work term, is this positive or negative? What do you think? Turns out this is positive because of our displacement. The displacement of point B is going from here over to this location here, is in the direction of that force. Okay, so let me just put a note out front here that this is a positive work term because we have force in the direction of displacement. All right, I think that's all the pieces that we need as we go to assemble our final equation. So our final equation, just writing out the terms, we have mgh1 plus the work of our forces equals our mgh2 plus 1/2. Actually, let me just, instead of writing out this full term, let me just put this as Ke sub 2. We've already dealt with the translational pieces and rotational pieces of that kinetic energy. We've lumped them into one single term. The value is actually right here. So let's go ahead and just write that as Ke 2. All right, looking at my gravitational potential energy, I need to pick a datum. My datum, in this case, I pick the ground. Now, you could pick the final location of the centroid or the initial location of the centroid, but we need to measure distances, basically a change in distances to that centroid, so I pick the bottom. So putting some numbers in here, we have 10, which is the mass, gravitational constant 9.81. The height initial is going to be 0.4 meters, right? Half of the length of that rod because it was standing vertically against the wall. Then bringing down the work of our 50 newton force, we have this is 50 newtons times 0.8 meters times the sine of 45 degrees. And this is equal to mgh2. We'll go ahead and bring the right-hand side of this equation down to the next line. So mgh2 is again 10 as the mass, gravitational constant 9.81, and then I guess I shouldn't call it the gravitational constant, more officially the gravitational acceleration constant for here on Earth. And then the distance now final is going to be this value here, 0.4 times the cosine of 45 degrees. And then we add in our final kinetic energy, which was 1.067 times omega 2 squared. Now, you do want to cross-check this equation that you can only have one unknown. So here's my single unknown, omega 2. Because this is a scalar equation, we'd need to bring in other equations if you had more than one unknown. And so solving through, we find that W2, my final angular velocity, is 6.11 radians per second. Now, if you wanted to, you could add in the direction of this, and we could say this is in the negative k hat. The negative k hat is going to come from observation. The negative k hat is going to come from observation, essentially matching up with this omega here as the body rotates down this wall. So just adding my note to say this is by observation. All right, so that is the kind of conceptual walkthrough and computations for one of these single body work energy problems. You can see a really critical step is listing out your full equation in some form and essentially getting rid of terms that go to zero. Make sure you do that step. It's really kind of an explicit part of your computations as opposed to just kind of jumping to a more simplified version where a whole bunch of things are already gone. But I hope this helps thinking about the single rigid body problems, and we'll follow this up with a video on multiple rigid body problems to see how we can assemble all these different terms for bodies in constrained motion. Hope you're having a great day.